When thinking of anonymity, your mind might jump to secret organizations, such as the hacker group Anonymous, or the inventor of Bitcoin, Satoshi Nakamoto. You might ask, is anonymity only reserved for criminals and rebels? Might anyone else want anonymity? Is anonymity in Bitcoin, or in cryptocurrencies and blockchain in general, only good for buying drugs? If I have nothing to hide, why go out of my way to stay anonymous? Anonymity is not about hiding illicit information as much as it is about protection, which, as most don't realize, applies to anyone and everyone. We'll go ahead and show some examples of how anonymity can apply to even the average person. Imagine it's just any other day. You're with your friend at McDonald's, ordering food, and it's time to pay. McDonald's refuses to split the bill, and you forget to order separately, so you volunteer to pay for the both of you. Your friend sends you some cryptocurrency later on to pay you back. Some time passes, and you decide to go to Bob's Burgers to make a purchase with your friend's cryptocurrency. However, Bob's Burgers doesn't accept your payment because your money is associated with drug dealers. Turns out, your friend has been making some shady purchases, and the cryptocurrency associated with these transactions made its way into your wallet. Not only is this bad, because now you'd have to question your friend, but this also affects the cryptocurrency's fungibility. Fungibility is the idea that every unit of currency must be equal in value to every other unit. Like in dealing with cash, for example, a dollar is a dollar. Fungibility is a crucial property of currency, and a deceit impacted this much in such a scenario shows that we probably want to enable anonymity. When vendors refuse to accept one unit of cryptocurrency over another, it reduces the fungibility of the currency and makes life harder for you too. Now let's consider a more drastic example. Say you're super wealthy, and the same McDonald's store cashier now sees that you're sitting on a stash of $60 million in Bitcoin. When they kidnap your mom next week, they know exactly how much money to blackmail you for. Pretty scary, huh? Even though you did nothing wrong, the exposure of information about your transaction history and financial standing put you in danger. Taking a step back, we can look at the origin of Bitcoin and blockchain to gain some perspective. We know that cypherpunks were individuals who advocated for privacy using cryptography, and that Satoshi Nakamoto appealed to this mentality with the publishing of the Bitcoin White Paper in 2008, and subsequent release in 2009. Bitcoin was designed as the first ever decentralized, pseudonymous, and trustless system for transactions, and the way to achieve that was with a blockchain. Initially, in designing Bitcoin, its creators wanted to get as far as possible from having any central entity, so they intended for every entity in Bitcoin to have the ability to be just as powerful as anyone else. They allowed anyone to store the blockchain. What this means, though, is that everyone has everyone's data. Users can see which addresses interact with each other, how much cryptocurrency each address has, and the like. Considering the normal user, which may not go out of their way to obfuscate their digital identity and activities with additional protection, it's easy to see how their transaction history and balance can be exposed to their detriment. It's clear that not all blockchains are anonymous by default. Fundamentally, blockchains take a central database and distribute it. However, this now means that you no longer have strong access control over your own data. All of the data stored on the blockchain is public by default, so everyone sees everything. There's no sense of guaranteed privacy. One note is that private or permissioned blockchains are slightly more anonymous, since read access to the database can be restricted. The focus of this week's material is on public blockchains, since the challenges of privacy in publicly readable databases are much more difficult and novel. As mentioned earlier with the creation of Bitcoin and addresses, now in terms of anonymity, most blockchains are not anonymous. Instead, most blockchains are pseudonymous. In most blockchains, we use a publicly verifiable but arbitrary identifier, such as your Bitcoin address. However, keeping your real name out of your identifier does not guarantee anonymity. These identifiers, like your Bitcoin address, are called pseudonyms. A pseudonym only implies that the user is not using their real identity, such as their name, email, or other personally identifying information. As such, it is very well possible to have the pseudonym linked to some real-world identity. For example, because all transactions are public on the blockchain, if even a single transaction by some Bitcoin address is linked to an actual identity, all other transactions conducted under that pseudonym are now connected to the real-world identity as well. All histories of transactions and any other activity that has been recorded on the blockchain all originally had no connection to a real person and only to a pseudonym. However, with one single connection between a pseudonym and a real-life identity, everything in their history can now be linked to the person that that identity belongs to. Therefore, most blockchains, including Bitcoin, are pseudonymous. In Bitcoin, and some blockchain platforms, it's generally best practice not to reuse pseudonyms. You could generate a new address every time you receive Bitcoin without much cost. With a new address for each transaction, there will be no way to link each of these Bitcoin addresses together. This separates the activity of each pseudonym. Hence, for someone to figure out all of your Bitcoin activity, they'd have to connect you to each of your pseudonyms, not just an individual one. This would be like creating a new Reddit account every time you leave a comment. Although it is more inconvenient to do so, it increases the difficulty of linking your accounts together, making it much harder for others to track your activity. This does introduce the slight hitch that one would have to keep track of each of these identities, but that can be easily resolved using wallet software, which often performs this by default. Just generate a new address every time you receive any cryptocurrency, or each time you use any sort of blockchain application. While this technique might be possible in Bitcoin and other blockchain applications, it's not possible in Ethereum. And that's because Ethereum is account-based, not UTXO-based. In Bitcoin, you could just generate a new address per UTXO every time you receive Bitcoin. It's much harder to do that in Ethereum and other account-based blockchains. And also, unfortunately, it turns out that basic analysis renders this technique of generating pseudonyms ineffective. Similar to a lock on a front door, generating new pseudonyms for every transaction does keep away naive attackers, but a determined opponent can probably find a way to link your activity together. The term linking in the context of anonymity is the act of associating a real-world identity to a pseudonym. Linking is also sometimes called de-anonymization. In Bitcoin, advanced linking can associate a real-world identity to an address. And same goes in Ethereum, where a real-world identity could be linked to an externally owned account. And the list goes on. Most of these blockchain technologies are fairly secure, though, for the most part, since linking, as we'll see, takes a non-trivial amount of effort. So as long as a user isn't reckless with how they manage their online identities, they can assume that most people aren't going to try to de-anonymize them. But see, that's the catch. The underlying technology might be anonymous or pseudonymous, but we still have to consider human factors. People make mistakes, especially your everyday normal person who isn't going out of their way to do all they can to possibly ensure their privacy. So what we like to say is that anonymity is not absolute, not a clear yes or no. Instead, it's on a spectrum. We refer to an entity's degree or level of anonymity as the difficulty of associating that entity's pseudonym with their real-world identity. A high degree of anonymity allows one to reasonably expect having achieved privacy. But again, why do we care about having a higher degree of anonymity? To deal with the question again of how anonymous cryptocurrencies can indeed be used for money laundering and online drug purchases, we can consider the following points. We could have a partial solution, where the interfaces between cryptocurrencies and fiat currencies are highly regulated. Recall the AML and KYC from the Enterprise Blockchain Lecture. For example, we might want to be able to trade cryptocurrencies almost anonymously, but not be able to touch fiat currency without a picture of your passport. Also, it's worth mentioning that it's immensely hard, if not impossible, to implement a sense of morality at a technological level. Moral and immoral use cases look identical from a technological standpoint, and more fundamentally, who gets to decide what's moral and immoral? At the end of the day, one might want to also consider whether the positive benefits of anonymity to society might outweigh the costs. For example, consider Tor. Tor was created by the US government, but now is used by many to make it difficult for government officials to monitor the web traffic, though there are still some ways to de-anonymize even this. And some users of Tor might be drug dealers or operating black markets. On the other hand, Tor has enabled free speech, for example, reporters in oppressive regimes. We leave further contemplation for you to do yourself. To round out our brief introduction as to why we might want anonymity in cryptocurrencies, we contrast our goals of anonymity, privacy, and security with that of decentralization. If we design our blockchain system to be decentralized, then what that means is that more of your data is in the network for people to publicly access. Like we saw earlier, decentralization implies everyone has equal control of everything, so more people will see your pseudonym. The more of your data that's on the network, though, the more data that's available to possibly de-anonymize you. This seems to show a slight paradox, where security and anonymity and privacy are harder and harder to ensure if we really want to be decentralized. And once again, we can tie this back to the fundamental trilemma we saw in earlier lectures.